Hello students, looking at current affairs for 30th April, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 9. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Home Ministry clears interstate movement of stranded people. So more than a month after countrywide lockdown owing to COVID-19 pandemic, now Ministry of Home Affairs has come up with guidelines to allow interstate movement of stranded migrant workers. So they are migrant workers, even pilgrims, students, tourists have been stranded and they need to go to their own state. Public transport including trains and buses still do not ply. They continue to remain suspended. But state governments have now been asked by Ministry of Home Affairs to appoint nodal authorities to register such stranded people and facilitate their movement. So if they want to travel by private cars, they can take permission from state authorities, and if these individuals want, they can avail the services provided. So buses shall be used for transportation of the group of these persons and they would be sanitized and shall follow safe social distancing norms in seating. And Ministry of Home Affairs has said that such persons should be kept in home quarantine for 14 days unless an assessment by medical team recommended institutional quarantine. So quarantine would be compulsory. The next is India reports 70 deaths, highest in a single day. So on 29th April, in the past 24 hours, India reported 17 COVID-19 deaths. And here you can see the doubling time for cases in Telangana and Kerala have slowed, but cases have doubled in 9.2 and 8.7 days in Gujarat and Maharashtra. The comparative analysis of states is shown here, you can see. So the x-axis shows tests, number of tests being conducted per million population. Million means 10 lakh. And the y-axis shows doubling time, that how much time is it taking for number of cases to double. So more the doubling time, the better. So you can see Telangana, Kerala are better off, though the number of tests conducted are low. And here you can see the number of, the doubling time then is here. For Haryana, Karnataka, Haryana, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu is conducting a lot of tests. You can see Delhi is at the highest order here. Gujarat, Maharashtra lie here. So the doubling time is less. Means number of cases are increasing quite fast. Bihar is at the lowest level. Then next is, are only 30 lakh found NREGA work in April. So, although the centre gave explicit instructions to reopen the flagship rural job scheme, that is the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act scheme, still it has been seen that as of April 20, only 30 lakh people were provided work under it all across the country. This is only 17% of the usual number of workers who are employed. If you compare it to mid-April the figures, it is only 1% of the usual number of workers. 17% in general over the year and 1% of what it would be in April. So it is an 82% drop from the previous year's figure. The previous year there were 1.7 crore workers provided work and now it's only 30 lakh. So that is even in March, previous month it was 1.6 crore workers who had found employment under the scheme. Some states had zero workers as on April 29. So this showed that they had not restarted their work sites at all. And this is a time when there is loss of livelihood due to lockdown and returning migrant workers are there. So this has increased the need for work in Indian villages. And there is a need for work being provided under MGNREGA. And if work can't be provided, then unemployment allowance should be provided. Already on 4th April, Mazdoor Kisan Shakti Sangathan filed a petition in the Supreme Court asking for full wages to be paid throughout the lockdown period to MGNREGA's 7.6 crore active job card holders. Even another intervention application had been filed on April 20, which asked for an interim measure of unemployment allowance to be paid to all those who were working on March 24 when the lockdown was announced. And also the scheme stipulates that if workers register for work but are not provided employment, is already provision in the MGNREGA Act, they should be paid unemployment allowance. This is also at the rate of 1/4, means 1/4 of their wages in the first month, they are not provided employment, even after being registered. Then 50% of the wages in the second month and full wages thereafter. So unemployment allowance is being sought under MGNREGA. Here you can see how the number of workers have significantly fell in April 2020. And this is regarding MGNREGA. It is first time that right to livelihood is not just a scheme, it is an act. So it is mandatory on the government to implement it. So it's an act of parliament. So it is National Rural Employment Guarantee Act of 2005. It was later renamed Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. What it provides for is that any adult who is willing to do unskilled manual work can register under it. And a minimum wage will be entitled to a minimum wage, which will be paid for the public work which he undertakes, and he should get work within 15 days of applying. If he does not get employment within, he or she does not get employment within 15 days, then he is entitled to an unemployment allowance. This provision is already there in the Act. Then next is, NEET applies to minority colleges, Supreme Court. So now the Supreme Court has held that National Eligibility Cum Entrance Test NEET, which is conducted for medical and dental and college admissions. So this will be mandatory for admission to medical colleges run by even religious and linguistic minority communities. So admissions will be solely through NEET for all graduate and postgraduate courses. And Supreme Court held that this does not violate any fundamental and religious rights of minorities. And NEET would apply to both aided and unaided medical colleges run by minorities. So Article 30 of the Constitution provides right to minorities to administer their institutions, but Supreme Court held that this provision, NEET, does not violate this fundamental right. There are reasonable restrictions, and NEET is intended to check maladies which crept into medical education. It wants to prevent capitation fee, which has been taken, means a huge sum which is taken from students who are lower in merit. So this exploitation which takes place, commercialization of education which takes place, profiteering has to be curbed, and that is what NEET intends to check. So NEET will be applicable for minority institutions too now. So NEET, which is conducted for undergraduates, it's earlier it was All India Pre-Medical Test which was conducted. Now it has been replaced by NEET UG. So, for all those who wish to study MBBS and BDS courses in government or private medical colleges, dental colleges, including now even minority colleges, they will have to pass through NEET. The NEET examination is presently conducted by NTA, National Testing Agency, which provides the results to Directorate General of Health Service at Ministry of Health. Prior to 2019, the test was administered by Central Board of Secondary Education, CBSC, in partnership with Prometric Testing Private Limited, headquartered in US. But now National Testing Agency has been appointed to undertake the tests. About National Testing Agency also, we should know it was established in 2017. Since 2019, it is conducting even the NEET UG exam. Otherwise, also along with it, it conducts JEE mains exam, which is for entrance exam to engineering colleges. Then NET, National Eligibility Test, which is for teachers entrance exam, teachers exam. Then this is Common Management Admission Test, so even for management courses, and Graduate Pharmacy Aptitude Test. All these tests are conducted by NTA, National Testing Agency now. Then next is UGC issues advisory for academic year. So universities and colleges have been advised by UGC to begin classes for second and third year students from 1st August and for final year students from 1st September. So this is just an advisory. It has clearly stated these are advices given. This is not mandatory. But with regard to current academic year also, UGC says that various modes of distance learning can be used to complete the course, and examinations can be held online or offline. And even final semester examinations can be held in July, and they may be shortened from 3 hours to 2 hour duration. And intermediate semester students can be graded based on internal assessment of the present and previous semester. So this is the UGC guideline advisory which has been issued. And it has also said that these guidelines clearly stated, these guidelines are advisory, not mandatory in nature. Institutions are free to take their decisions as required based on their own facilities and local restrictions due to COVID-19. Also, UGC has emphasized that colleges and universities should equip their faculties with online teaching tools, develop virtual classrooms and virtual laboratory facilities too. So this is the UGC advisory. Then next is, India remains on US priority watch list. So India continues to be on the priority watch list of United States Trade Representative So it comes out with a report every year. So it's annual 301, special 301 report comes out, in which it mentions countries in priority watch list, which are countries where there are not enough intellectual property rights protection. So if there is lack of adequate intellectual property rights protection and enforcement, country finds its mention in this annual special 301 under priority watch list. And India has remained as one of the challenging economies for USA under this, and we have continued to remain in priority watch list again now. So India, it has says, the report says, has made meaningful progress to enhance intellectual property protection and enforcement in some areas over the past year, but it did not resolve recent and long-standing challenges and created new ones. So similar assessment was made even in 2019 report. So there are long-standing issues, and then new issues also arise. So basically, it is regarding how India receives, maintains, and enforces patents, and concerns of USA are mainly in the pharmaceutical sector. Copyright laws issues are there. Also, report has stated that high custom duties on medical devices had been announced by Indian government. That was in news. So on medical devices and even on IT, information communication technology related devices, the high custom duties which have been announced go against intellectual property rights protection. So these are the trade concerns which USA has. So it also says that online intellectual property enforcement has begun in India. It has improved, but still there are concerns like weak enforcement by courts and the police, lack of familiarity with investigative techniques, and no centralized intellectual property enforcement agency. So these are the concerns which have been raised in the Special 301 report of USA. So it's not that we do not have a centralized intellectual property agency. We have the Office of Controller General of Patents, Design and Trademarks under Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade under Ministry of Commerce. So that is there. But this is what the Special 301 report of US Trade Representative mentions. So this is a provision under its act. The Trade Act of 1974 of USA has this provision, Special 301, and it identifies trading partners that deny adequate and effective protection of intellectual property or deny fair and equitable market access to US artists and industries. So it's an annual review which is done, and India remains in priority watch list. The next is study on China dams brings the Brahmaputra into focus. So a new study highlighting the impact of China's dams on Mekong River have raised fresh concerns on whether dams which are being built by China on other rivers that originate in China may be affected, such as Brahmaputra, which flows from China into India. So this was actually a study funded by the US government and has been dismissed by USA. By China. So the study says that there was severe lack of water in the lower Mekong in the May to October period, and satellite data from 1992 to 2019 shows that the countries have been affected because of this. There was a drought in 2019. So study countries downstream also say there's more study needed. There's also Mekong River Commission, which says more studies needed to understand whether it was dams built by China on Mekong River which have caused the drought. So Mekong River, it flows from China into Myanmar, Laos, Thailand, Cambodia, and Vietnam. So, and it's not the only river which flows. There are tributaries joining it too. Here you can see this is Mekong River. So whether it was only China's dams which had resulted in drought, this has not been completely accepted even by the Mekong River Commission. So this is the flow of Mekong River. And this is Brahmaputra flow too, you should know. Brahmaputra is known as Yalung Zhangbo in China, so in Tibet. Here you can see it flows through China and then takes this hairpin bend, a U-turn in Arunachal Pradesh, and enters into India. So Lohit and the rivers here, they meet, and Brahmaputra is formed. So Brahmaputra River, then from India it enters into Bangladesh, where Brahmaputra is known as Jamuna. So it has different names, you can see. And Jamuna then meets Ganga. Ganga from India, when it enters into Bangladesh, it is called Padma. So Jamuna and Padma meet in Bangladesh, and the combined flow is called Meghna River, which drains into Bay of Bengal. So this is it. So here you can see. So India has also concerns because dam building activities taking place on Brahmaputra also. China has undertaken building dams. In 2015, it operationalized its first hydropower project here at Zangmu on Brahmaputra River. So Indian officials have raised concerns regarding the dam activity, but it is said that these are run-of-the-river dams. So China keeps maintaining that all the dams it is building are run-of-the-river dams, means they are not blocking water, they are only storing water for power generation, not for, you know, utilizing the water. So that is what it says. So Brahmaputra dams are also said to be of the same nature. And also it is said Brahmaputra is not entirely dependent on upstream flows. An estimated 35% of its basin is in India. And Brahmaputra actually causes floods. Also China-India cooperation is there. Water sharing agreement is there. Water sharing agreement is not there on, as such on between India and China. But both sides share hydrological data. Because Brahmaputra causes floods. And warnings on how floods are moving down Yalung Zangpo into Brahmaputra. When China cooperates with us and provides this agreement, provides this information, we can better equip our population downstream, you know, in Arunachal Pradesh. Then next is US economy shrinks 4.8% in Q1, fall sharpest since 2009. So US economy has shrank at 4.8% as such. That is, it is in minus 4.8% in the first quarter of 2020. So this is due to the COVID-19 pandemic, which has shut down much of the country, and it has begun triggering a recession that will end the longest expansion on record as such to in USA. So this is it is said to be the sharpest fall since the economy shrank at 8.4% annual rate in the fourth quarter of 2008 during the Great Recession. So this is 2008, you can see the sharpest fall. Then the last news is banks borrow 2000 crore from RBI for mutual funds. So RBI had provided a liquidity window of 50,000 crore for mutual funds, out of which commercial banks have borrowed only 2000 crore so far. The scheme is available from April 27 till May 11, 2020, or up to the time when the allocated amount is utilized. So this act of RBI, the RBI has initiated this after the Franklin Templeton Mutual Fund decided to wind up 6 debt funds. So the Franklin Templeton Mutual Fund wound up its funds because it said it wants to preserve the value at least at the current levels, because stocks values are keeping on falling, so the value would completely get eroded. So that is why it has decided to wrap up these funds, wind up these funds. So such a scenario does not arise and other mutual funds do not follow suit. That's why RBI came up with this liquidity window through which our banks can provide funds to mutual fund institutions. So this is regarding Franklin India funds also. How many, these are the 6 mutual funds which it wrapped up. Total asset under management was 25,856 crores. So that is it. Thank you.